What's up, Jonas B here from DroneTech, brought to you by RemotePilot101.com. And today we're gonna talk about the Mavic 2 camera settings. It's a question I get all the time, so let's jump in. To walk you through this camera settings, the first thing I'm gonna tell you is that yes, I am a professional drone cinematographer, but I am not a director of photography, so I do not understand all of the camera science, and neither do you. It is helpful to understand all that, but I'm gonna give you how I set up my camera to be able to work with the director of photography that I work with and how I talk to them. So I'm just gonna walk you through each and every single one of the camera settings of the typical flight of how I use it. And obviously you can go from there. And the noise you're hearing right now is actually the fan on the Mavic 2. Obviously it's sitting still, normally it doesn't have to have the fan on, but when sitting still, it does that. So you're gonna hear that this whole time because I'm doing the camera settings for y'all. And also this episode is partially brought to you by my homie Russell. Is at Where's Russ and Where's Russ on YouTube. And this is actually his drone with the cool stickers and stuff because he does stuff like that. Shout out to Russell for letting me borrow his drone to do this video for y'all. After you get your drone on and you know you're in a safe area and you're gonna fly, it's time to set up your camera. The first thing you're gonna do is right below the record button, which should be a big red circle. If it's not, then you need to switch your camera from photo to video mode. If it's in photo mode, it's a white circle. So when you flip it, which is the button right above the circle on the right side, it will turn red. Directly underneath that is a little slide looking thing. You click that and that gives you your camera settings. On the top, you have three options across the top that tell you the different types of settings you can be inside of. All the way to the left, you have the ISO as well as the shutter. Typically, the default setting for this is everything's gonna be in automatic. I never fly in automatic. You always wanna be in manual, and here's how you set that up. You switch the setting on the top over to the big M, and this gives you the ability to control the shutter speed as well as the ISO. Now, you always want, typically, the ISO to be as low as you can get it to be. So I always slide it down to 100. The native, when you're flying log, sometimes can be 400. But for this particular drone, I always want to get it to have 100, to be as low as possible, because the higher the ISO, typically the more granular things you're going to see in the image, which you don't want to see. ISO is meant for low light filming. So if there's not enough light and you're not being able to see the subject, you can raise your ISO. But typically you want to raise that as little as possible. And the native ISO on these drones is actually a matter of debate because DJI isn't very clear about what that native ISO is. So sometimes if you're on set or you're working with video professionals, they'll say, what's the native ISO of that camera? DJI doesn't really tell you that. So I typically just tell them it's 100. It's a safe bet to go. That's what it starts out at, and that's the lowest setting for the ISO. And that's typically where you're gonna get your highest quality image anyway. But there's a little bit of debate on that. Some people say it might be 200 or 400, but I'm saying 100, and that's where you wanna stick. Underneath that, you have your shutter speed. Typically, now this gets into the camera science, you want your shutter speed to be a multiple of your frame rate. And so for me, I normally go to slide it down to 1/50th. That is where I start everything whenever I'm gonna start flying a drone and say, I want my camera settings to be at 1/50th. Now, you'll notice that when you're in automatic mode, the shutter, when you're on a bright sunny day, will automatically go all the way up to a really high number to compensate for how bright it is outside. But that's what you have ND filters for. Highly, highly recommend that you always get ND filters for any type of drone that you're flying, because especially if you can't control the aperture on that drone, like you cannot do on the Mavic 2 Zoom, you can do that on the Mavic 2 Pro. Either way, you don't want to have to use the aperture or the shutter speed to control for the brightness of what it is outside. You want to use your ND filters. Typically on a bright sunny day, you'll be looking at an ND 16 or ND 32, depending on how bright it is. But going down from there, depending on how bright it is, you typically just put it on there and you try to get these settings like I just told you. You want it to be at ISO 100 and your shutter speed 1/50th. To simplify your shutter speed, if you're shooting at 24 frames, you want to be at 1/50th. If you're shooting at 30, you want to be at 1/60th. It's pretty much double whatever your frame rate is what you want your shutter speed to be. So then moving on to the next part of the settings, now you're going to get into the different video size and formatting and how you set up what it's going to look like. Pretty much every time I fly, I'm always in 4K 24. So that's the very top setting, video size, 4K, 24 frames. Depending on what kind of project you're doing, if it's just something for your Instagram or YouTube, you might wanna go down to 1080 or 2.7K. But for any client I'm flying for, typically you want the space to be able to zoom in, 4K will give you that. Underneath that, you have the video format, it's MP4 or MOV. In all honesty, there's not a huge difference between the two. I recommend MOV, that's just what I use. MP4 is just fine. You're not really gonna hurt yourself on either side of that. For your white balance, that depends on what it is like outside. I typically do a custom white balance. If it's sunny outside, you wanna have your white balance at 5600. If it's cloudy outside, then you want it to go up to 6000. And honestly, those numbers you can play with just a little bit depending on how much cloud cover there is, you know, by 100 or so. But for the most part, those are the standards you wanna stick with that'll make it look like it has the natural color that you want. So for color, you only have two choices, Decenni-like and normal. Decenni-like is shooting a flat mode, which makes all of your footage look gray when you get it into your computer and when you start editing with it. Now, this really depends on what you're shooting for. If you're shooting for a professional company that's going to color grade the footage, or you plan to color grade the footage yourself, you always want to shoot decently light. That's going to give you more color space to be able to play and push those colors further than you can if you put it in normal mode, where you're going to have the colors that look how they are when you're flying. So that's a more natural setting. That's what it's going to look like. It's going to come out looking good, but you'll be able to match other cameras better if you use decently light and you also know what you're doing on the color side of things. And for the other Mavic series and other Phantom series and other things like that, there's also a setting sometimes called D-Log, and that is super flat. And we never use that simply because after playing with the color space, we found that decently light is all the color space you need, and it works a lot better from a baseline than it does a D-Log. And on a lot of these prosumer-like drones, it's honestly, you're not getting enough information from the camera sensor to be able to really mess with a log type setting. So I know that's not an option for this one, but in other Mavics, you can shoot D-Log, and the Phantoms and the Inspires, you might be able to do that. If you have a decently-like option, I recommend that over D-Log pretty much any time. And for all the colorists out there that are ready to argue with me in the comment section, you might be able to do it, all right? I'm not a professional colorist. I have worked with a lot of productions. They all seem very happy with decently-like, but if you can make it work with D-Log, you do your thing. It's all you. After that, we have the camera video coding. And the camera video coding is two options as well. It's H.264 and H.265. H.265, if you're going to be doing the color work and really pushing and moving the footage around, it actually has more data in there to play with. But it comes with a caveat. If you shoot an H.265, you can't replay the footage on a computer. You just can't. It's going to skip. It's going to stop. You need to process it in some kind of program like Adobe before you can actually even watch the footage back. Where in H.264, you can just put it in Finder in like a MacBook or something like that and just press spacebar and it'll just play. So depending on what you're doing, once again, that setting is important. I typically, when I'm flying for a client, fly H.265 or for a big project, but if I'm doing something for me, I put it in H.264. And then on the bottom, you have a setting for the image format. It's either JPEG or RAW, and you can actually make that either or. And for me, if I'm doing photos, I just make it so that it's both. It gives me a JPEG image and a RAW, because if I don't want to go through and edit everything like on a RAW photo, then I have the JPEG right there. It's good to go. Next up is all the different camera settings that you can do to be able to work on your display. That's all the way to the right. This setting here is one of the first settings I always activate whenever I fly a drone, is the histogram setting. And what the histogram is, pretty much if you're outside and you're flying and you don't have a proper monitor and you can't tell if you're over or underexposed, this is the best gauge on these drones to be able to tell you that. Simply put, on the left side of it is underexposed, on the right side is overexposed. What you want to have is a lot of information in the middle of that, so that you're seeing just a white little lump right in the middle of this histogram that's not touching the right side of the frame, which will be overexposed, or the left side. That's pretty much the simplest way to put it. If you're not touching either one of those sides, your image is good, light-wise, to go. So this really, for me, is just your double check just to make sure that your image isn't over or underexposed, because sometimes the monitors can lie to you and you get into the post-production, or a client will get into post-production and say all your shots were overexposed in the whites or they're underexposed in the darks. But you'll know that when you look at your histogram, because it'll tell you while you're looking at the image if you're over or underexposed. So after that, the only other thing is I normally put my grid lines on just to make sure that my horizon is correct. I typically do just the regular. There's three different ways you can do it. There's none, there's grid lines, and there's grid lines with diagonals. I typically just use the grid lines, and that's just to make sure that the gimbal is okay. You look at the horizon and those lines line up with the horizon as a straight line, you're good to go. If it's looking like the horizon's a little bit off, it's really easy to tell with those grid lines, as well as to be able to help you with the rule of thirds to be able to do any kind of framing that you want to do. Don't make the mistake that I've made way more times than I care to admit it. Make sure you have your SD card in your drone before you take off. And also, even before you take off, you probably should format that just so it's good for that particular drone. But after that, you're good to go. So these are the baseline camera settings. I highly recommend, if you're gonna be on any kind of film set or anything like that, you talk to the camera professionals and see if they have any special settings that they want. They might be in a specific white balance. They might want to overexpose or underexpose because of some creative plan or something like that. So just make sure you talk to who you're flying with, and if they don't know what they want, then this is what you should default to, is the settings that I just told you. To sum it all up, you want your ISO to be as low as you can get it. You want your shutter speed to be double your frame rate. And using your histogram, you want to find your proper exposure using your ND filters, as well as, if you have it, your aperture control. So consider your ISO and your shutter speed locked. You don't want to change that. The only thing you're changing is ND filters and aperture if you have access to that. All right, droners, thank you so much. Let me know if you guys set up your cameras any differently or anything that helps you do your drone cinematography. This, once again, is Droner Tech, brought to you by RemotePilot101.com. And as always, I want to make sure you guys stay fly.